Did you listen or watch Sean Carroll's podcast on the crisis in physics?
I skimmed through the transcript, but I thought the whole thing was actually quite strange because it's like four and a half hours long. Anyway, I thought the whole thing was actually very odd, and it has something to do with kind of the odd nature of the response to the criticisms in the subject. And so I think it was another kind of weird example. It's, you know, he's kind of wants to say something about this issue of, you know, that many people are now kind of very aware there is some kind of problem here, and they're referring to it as a crisis in physics. But just kind of talking about it for 4 hours, 4.5 hours yourself is just kind of strange. And especially since he's got a podcast, one of the obvious things to do is to invite somebody on who, you know, thinks there is a crisis in physics. And if you don't, and he doesn't think there's one, it seems, and well, you could actually have an interesting discussion with this person for some time. But instead, it's like, you know, there's a controversy going on of two kinds. And instead of inviting somebody on to discuss this controversy with you or two people, you just go on for 4 hours about how your view that the other, you know, the other side is wrong. It was very odd, I thought.
Also, it wasn't as if he was arguing with the people that were saying that there's a crisis in physics. So when people say there's a crisis in physics, they generally mean that there's a crisis in high energy physics, particularly with coming up with fundamental law. And so what he was then taking it on to mean is there's a crisis in physics as a whole, like cosmology or astrophysics. Yeah. And then he's like, no, but look in solid state physics and the progress there. That's called a straw man, where you're not actually taking on the argument. You're taking on a diminished version of it.
Well, he was also often involved in these arguments over string theory with me and Lee in 2006. And it was often, I mean, and the whole thing is just odd from beginning to end, because he's actually not a string theorist. And this is another weird sociological thing I found, is that you find non-string theorist physicists who somehow want to take a bit side in this and have a big opinion about it and get emotionally involved in it, even though they actually don't actually understand the issues. This is not what they do. This is not their expertise. I think some of this, you know, knowing Sean and what he's trying to do, I think he's not the only one who you see this phenomenon, that there are people who they see what they want to do in the world is really to bring to the public an understanding of the power and the great things that the subject has accomplished. And so even in his 4 hours, he spends a lot of time, you know, giving very, very good explanations of, you know, various parts of the story of the history of the physics and the history of this. And, you know, they kind of see them, their goal in life is to kind of convince this, you know, the rest of the world who doesn't actually understand these great ideas or doesn't really appreciate them or is skeptical about them, you know, to bring them to them. And I think the whole reason is, I think he was kind of doing this or does this is because having people out there on Twitter or whatever saying, oh, you know, physics sucks, it's got all these problems, it's all wrong, blah, 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 that this is, you know, this is completely against his whole goal in life, is to stop this kind of thing and to really get people to appreciate the subject. So he, I think, in a kind of a misguided way, then enters into this from the point of view of, oh, I have to stop this kind of crisis, people from saying things about a crisis in physics, and get them to really appreciate, you know, that this really is a great subject and a wonderful subject. And it's, but he kind of then goes too far and then, you know, starts to defending things which really aren't defensible and things which he often doesn't really know much about.
For instance,
just the details of string theory. I mean, the reason I wrote this book is that some of these problems of string theory, these questions, you know, people will go on about ADS, CFT and this and blah, 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 blah. I mean, this is incredibly technical stuff. To even understand exactly what these theories are that on both sides of the ADS, CFT thing, what is known about them? What are they, you know, what is the real problem here? What can you calculate? What can you not calculate? What can you not find? What can you not find? What happens in other dimensions? Mm-hmm. It's horrendously technical, and very few people actually really know it, but lots of people want to kind of get involved in discussions about it and argue about it without actually understanding actually what's going on. And part of the reason for writing the, you know, to sit down and try to write about what was really going on, what the specific technical issues actually were, you know, as much as possible with it in a somewhat non-technical venue. But anyway, so that's some of my reaction to this. And in particular, I mean, he just starts off the whole thing by, he picked up on something from Twitter about somebody had found a paper from somebody written in the 1970s complaining about how, you know, there was a crisis, there wasn't any progress in the field. And this was a time when there was great progress in the field. And and this was a person who honestly, just somebody completely ignorant, wrote a completely paper no one ever paid attention to in the mid-1970s that was wrong about this. And he wanted to use that and as to kind of bludgeon the people who are making serious arguments about the problems today. So I don't know. I thought it was kind of a weird performance, but it is, I think this is a good thing to ask kind of people on this other side of this argument, string theory, why there's very little willingness to actually engage in technical discussions publicly with people they disagree with. I mean, you know, Sean has never invited me to be on his podcast. He hasn't invited Sabina Hassenfelder. It's not, there is no appetite for that at all among people in this subject. And I think, you know, a lot of that is because, you know, they're well aware that, you know, they're really serious, difficult problems with this going, whether you want to call it a crisis or whatever it is, there are real problems, and they're just not very interested kind of acknowledging and publicizing that.
Yeah. Well, I have a tremendous appetite for it, and the people in the audience of the Theories of Everything do. So if ever you have someone who you feel like would be a great guest with the opposite view that is defending string theory or the state of high energy physics, then please let me know, and I will gladly host you both.
Okay.
I know we spoke about some people behind the scenes, some people who are likely to say yes and have a congenial conversation.
Well, there's actually most people are. I mean, there's the funny thing is actually early on in this, I was invited. A guy down at University in Florida invited me and Jim Gates to come and debate string theory. And so we I think we really disappointed this big audience by agreeing on almost everything. So, you know, he's a well-known string theorist, and you know, and so we actually found that I think things have be interesting to do this again now, but this was almost 20 years ago, but maybe a little bit less, 15 years ago. And, you know, the way I would describe it then is that, you know, if we started talking about the details, what our disagreements came down to where it was kind of more, you know, should you be out, you know, we would agree about the state of current things, but what do you think, where do you think this stuff is going? Are you optimistic? I see reasons why this can't work. He would see reasons why this is actually best thing to do. He knows how to do, and this might work. And there, it's just that kind of, you know, disagreement about ideas, which is perfectly reasonable. And actually, Gates told me, I remember at the end of when we were talking after this thing, he said, yeah, you know, I was asked to, like, you know, write a review of your book about it. And I thought, oh, well, I'll pick up this book and I'll see, you know, the guy's got it all wrong about string theory and whatever. And then, you know, I read your book and I realized that, you know, a lot of what you were saying was the stuff about, that the importance of representation theory in physics, and I actually, you know, that's actually exactly the way I see what's important in physics. So I find myself agreeing with much of your point of view and the book. So I didn't, anyway, so that was, you know, at the level of these ideas, I think, you know, especially back then, I think there wasn't, it's perfectly possible to have a reasonable discussion. I think it has become weirder now. You know, 20 years later, they're really, I think it was a lot more possible to reasonably be an optimist back 20 years ago and say, well, you know, the LHC is about to turn on. It's going to look for these super partners. Maybe they'll see super partners. There's, you know, we have all this stuff that might vindicate us, and we're all hoping for that. But now, you know, the LHC has looked, the stuff is not there. There's really not, and, you know, that's one thing that somewhat shocked me is people willing to, people who are often to me or in public saying, look, you know, the crucial thing is going to be the results from the LHC. You know, we believe that we're going to see these super partners, and this is going to show that we're right on the right track. And then the results come in and, you know, you're wrong, and you just kind of keep going and without even kind of skipping a beat about how, yeah. Anyway, that's, I think, yeah. Really,
Well, there was a comment on your blog that said the LHC has just, it's great for string theory because it divides in half the moduli space.
Anyway, you can make any kind of joke you want, but that was certainly my feeling a lot when I was writing the book, whatever, is that, you know, this was going to be a crucial thing, this the LHC, because either the LHC was going to see something along the lines of what these guys were advertising, and which they were often willing to kind of actually bet money on, or it wouldn't, and then they would back down and start saying, okay, well, maybe the critics have a point. But no, I mean, it's just kind of amazing that people would just kind of completely ignore the experimental results and keep going.
Sean, I'm a huge fan of yours. The Theories of Everything channel is open. If you ever want to have a congenial, moderated discussion with you and Peter Woit on this topic, it can even be on your podcast, any place. I respect and admire you, man. If you enjoyed that clip, then the full podcast is out right now. You can click around here. Enjoy. Subscribe to Theories of Everything to get notified of upcoming podcasts, as there are new full-length podcasts every week on the topics of mathematics, physics, consciousness, free will, and AI.